The overlooked cause of COPD. We all know smoking is bad for our health. Regardless of what substance is being smoked, it is universally known that inhaling smoke is bad for our health. Even if we dry out some broccoli, grind it up, and roll it into a cigarette, smoking it is unhealthy. With all the research that's been done over the years on COPD diseases, it's surprising they still have not determined the cause of the progression of COPD. In case you don't know, COPD is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and is an umbrella term that covers a family of diseases that includes emphysema, chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, and more recently, asthma. We assume the cause is due to smoking. However, millions of people quit smoking and are subsequently diagnosed many years later with COPD. Leonard Nimoy, the actor who played Spock on the popular TV and movie series Star Trek, quit smoking and died from COPD 29 years later. So if smoking causes COPD, what is causing the progression of the disease years and even decades after the patient quit smoking? When I asked my mother's pulmonary specialist why her emphysema was progressing 2.5 years after she quit smoking, his response surprised me. He said, "We don't know why emphysema progresses long after the patient quits smoking. It's a mystery." That was the moment I decided I would research the cause of the progression of COPD until I either found the answers or my mother took her last breath. That began my 4.5 year research study that ended in a comprehensive understanding of why COPD progresses long after the patient quit smoking. My mother had been a smoker for 40 years and had just been diagnosed with emphysema. She was very scared. I realized there are two distinct things going on when we smoke cigarettes. The first and most obvious is the inhaling of smoke from the lit tobacco in the cigarette. We know from common sense that inhaling smoke from anything is bad for our overall health, and more specifically, our lung health. The second and until now previously unknown cause of the progression of COPD is the inhaling of active fungal spores that I believe are present on the tobacco during the growing phase, during the curing phase, and also during the consumption phase, which is, of course, smoking the cigarette. I believe it begins in the fields where the tobacco is growing. We know for a fact that blue mold is oftentimes present on the tobacco leaves while it is growing in the fields. We also know it's present on tobacco that is curing for processing and consumption. They apparently do not discard tobacco that is infected with blue mold, so what tobacco do they discard? Are they visually inspecting the tobacco for fungi and mold? It sure doesn't seem like it. If my assumptions are correct, the fungi that are growing on the tobacco in the fields make it into the cigarettes, and we inhale active fungal spores from that fungi into our lungs when we smoke. You see, the tobacco at the end of the cigarette is lit on fire. The fungal spores in this tobacco are consumed in fire. The smoke from the burning tobacco is then inhaled through the remaining unlit tobacco that I believe contains active fungal spores. So two things are occurring when we smoke cigarettes. First, we are inhaling smoke from the burning tobacco, and second, we are inhaling active fungal spores from the fungi present on the tobacco. Once in the lungs, these active fungal spores are planted like a garden into a warm, moist environment with a plentiful blood supply, which helps supply nutrients to and remove waste from the fungi, keeping it alive and healthy. Now, if the patient quits smoking, their lungs heal from the smoke inhalation and their body replaces every cell in their lungs over the next 1.5 to 2 years. The problem is, the garden of fungi has been planted in our lungs and is still growing. I believe the fungi that invades the lungs and causes the progression of COPD is an opportunistic fungi. Opportunistic fungi differ from pathogenic fungi in that they are not easily eradicated since they emulate human cells and can easily go undetected by the immune system. Most COPD patients have been given multiple prescriptions for antibiotics, which kill 80% of our immune system, namely the probiotics. Opportunistic fungi also adapt to treatments very rapidly, so any attempt at killing these fungi with, say, an antifungal medication is generally ineffective and futile, especially if the fungi has been growing in the patient's lungs for 2 or 3 decades or even longer. Alternative treatments have been developed that constitute 6 protocols for eradicating the opportunistic fungi that I believe is causing the progression of COPD. But do they work? As the old saying goes, the proof is in the pudding. If the progression of COPD is caused by an opportunistic fungi, and killing the opportunistic fungi is possible, albeit difficult, then what proof is there that these alternative treatments actually kill this fungi and reverse COPD in human patients? By the time I began applying the alternative treatments from the 6 protocols I developed to my mother's daily regimen, she had already deteriorated down to end-stage emphysema, weighing only 77 pounds, down from 103. She required 4 liters of continuous supplemental oxygen by that time and was gasping for air much of the time, even on 4 liters of oxygen. She could only eat a small portion of food, little more than a cup, before she would complain that if she ate another bite, she would not be able to breathe. After about 3 weeks on the alternative treatments, I began noticing subtle improvements in her condition. She would walk into the kitchen each morning after I made coffee. She was usually gasping for air by the time she got there. After only 3 weeks of following these alternative treatments, she appeared in the kitchen but was not gasping for air. It didn't seem that she was in any distress at all. Even though it was a tiny improvement, it was an improvement. Anyone who has this disease or is around someone who has it knows the patient's condition slowly worsens over time but never improves other than the temporary improvements you may see from using the prescribed medication. My complaints regarding the prescribed medications was that I could see temporary improvements from using the medications, but by the next day her improvements had disappeared and she was back where she started and probably a little bit worse with no permanent improvements resulting from using the medications. It was obvious to me that the disease was progressing in spite of the fact that my mother was taking all of the prescribed medications, which provided nothing more than temporary relief from the symptoms of COPD. These alternative treatments included a restrictive but extremely healthy diet and a number of supplements, each one addressing one specific aspect of the disease from the perspective of killing the opportunistic fungi residing in the lungs that was causing the progression of COPD. The diet I used was developed by Dr. Kenneth Hunter, a microbiologist and cancer researcher at the University of Nevada School of Medicine in Reno. He has successfully used this diet in his research for more than 15 years to starve cancer. Dr. Hunter stated that cancer was a pathogen. Dr. Furman touts the vegetarian version of this same diet on PBS as the cure for every chronic disease. Well, wouldn't that include chronic obstructive pulmonary disease? I kept my mother on these alternative treatments for 17 months until she had completely recovered, regaining all of her lost weight and no longer requiring any supplemental oxygen. And yes, that's me behind her in the picture. It was truly one of the happiest days of my life. The opportunistic fungi had been eradicated. My mother carried her portable oxygen tank around with her for about a month after she recovered, but never needed it. I wrote a book detailing each step I took in reversing my mother's emphysema entitled, How I Reversed My Mom's Emphysema. The book has now sold in 37 countries, and many thousands have reported a complete recovery. It seems every time these people try and publicize the fact that they recovered from COPD and tell of the method and source of the information they used in accomplishing this amazing recovery, they are met with internet trolls who try and force them to retract their statements and denounce the methods. I can only assume these trolls are employed by someone who is not in favor of COPD patients recovering without the use of any prescription medications. They are obviously unaware of the book, The Allergy and Asthma Cure, written by Dr. Fred Pescatore. Dr. Pescatore is a practicing MD in New York City. In this book, Dr. Pescatore details his 8-step process of eliminating allergies and asthma. If you have asthma and allergies, did your doctor tell you about Dr. Pescatore's book or prescribe medications? His 8 steps are amazingly similar to the 6 protocols I used in reversing my mother's emphysema. Dr. Pescatore and I arrived at almost the exact same conclusions after our respective research. It is no surprise to me that asthma is often included in the COPD diseases list. So if you believe the trolls and do not feel comfortable getting my book, then get Dr. Pescatore's book, and when you realize you're recovering, get my book for the finishing touches that pertain specifically to COPD. If any of the prescribed COPD medications provided permanent improvements in the patient's condition, I would help them promote it. The sad fact is, the only improvements I ever saw with my mother while she was taking these medications were temporary improvements that completely disappeared by the next day and she would start all over again. Common sense tells us that temporarily masking symptoms of a progressive disease is not a survivable solution. Why? Because the disease is continuing its progression unabated and will eventually kill us. If you would like additional information on how these protocols reversed my mom's emphysema, please visit the website below. You will find the book, How I Reversed My Mom's Emphysema, which includes Dr. Hunter's diet that I used, as well as the supplements, with a detailed description of why I used each one and what the improvements were in my mother's condition after adding each one to her daily regimen. There is also a book that just covers the diet I used, the new menu that began my mother's recovery from COPD and emphysema, which is the first 4 chapters of the main book. You will also find information on our COPD focus group. Everyone in the focus group is improving. I have a gentleman who will most likely leave the group soon since he has nearly recovered. When he joined the group over a year ago, he had just had a CT scan. His radiologist had shown him on the CT scan that both of his lungs were completely full of scar tissue. The radiologist explained that the scar tissue would be there forever. 7 months after joining our COPD focus group, he had another CT scan which showed all of the scar tissue was gone. And yes, this was the scar tissue the radiologist told him would be there forever, and now, only 7 months later, it was completely gone. His last checkup showed that he had only a tiny bit of emphysema in one lung, and that was all that was left. His doctor at the VA had told him on a previous visit that she could not say in his medical record that he was improving, because that was not allowed for COPD patients at the VA. All she could say was that he was stable. Sounds like the VA should look into this policy immediately. On a subsequent visit, after seeing how much he had improved and that his emphysema was nearly gone, she decided she would go against protocol and say in his medical record that he was greatly improved. I'm not sure what the ramifications of her entry in his medical record will cause. Only time will tell. The COPD focus group provides one-on-one assistance to each member via weekly group sessions, text messages, emails, and even phone calls. Each week, a different aspect of the alternative treatments is covered in detail, so each member gains a full and complete understanding of each step in the recovery process. So if what I'm saying here makes more sense than what you've been told about COPD, and you'd like additional information, please visit our website at www.emphysema-treatments.com.